إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، فإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the only one worthy of praise. I seek His help, His guidance, and His forgiveness. I believe in Him and I trust Him. I seek refuge in Almighty Allah from the evil of our passions. Indeed, whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides him to Al-Islam, no one can mislead him after Allah. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him astray, no one can guide him after Allah. I testify openly that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah Rabbil Alameen. And I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger and the seal of all the prophets. O Muslims, you must know that the best speech is the speech of Almighty Allah, which is the Quran. The best guidance is the course of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is his sunnah. The worst of all affairs is innovation and addition to the religion of Islam. Indeed, every addition to the religion of Islam will lead to hellfire. I adjure you as well as myself to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of your ability. Fear Allah and don't die unless you are in a state of Islam. Greet you all with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and the blessing of Almighty Allah be with you all. Inshallah, tonight we have at-tarbiyah ala al-adab al-nabawiyya wa sunan al-mustafa. Mustafawiya. This is a class of nourishment, discipline, and this class number 45, the adab and the tarbiyah, fostering according the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you may allow me to be a little bit personal tonight, that does not mean that I'm trying to single somebody in the class, but I look to the people who come to the class, the people who are more concerned about learning their deen. But the issue is not only a matter of learning, neither the improvement will come by learning. Learning is one step, but putting things in action, observing, and the teacher also to be observer and be concerned about the students in some kind of tariqah. We don't have a tariqah other than the tariqah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But on those people who have, they have a murid and they have a sheikh, a seeker and a leader. They teach their students and they will take whatever the sheikh is saying almost with no question. And sometimes we, the people of sunnah, sometimes when we single somebody or to say something to somebody, feel that why the Imam is so personal, you understand, or mentioning my name, anything like this, is because that I care. And this is the only way that we need to learn, we need to practice, we need observation, and we need to understand all these things to come together to bring about a new generation and better community. Few minutes ago, I noticed that we have three sisters sitting here, and one sister sitting this side, okay? Same way like every day, we see how Muslims and Jum'ah, all these things. This is part of the tarbiyah. Like I said, part of it is that the sheikh or the teacher or the leader, okay, the person who pointing the way to the people to observe his students and the people who try to learn and to grow in their deen. And an incident like this, and I mentioned it in the khutbah many times, that the Prophet ﷺ was traveling with the Sahaba. And when they go camping, the people start to disperse. Everybody, two people in one side, three people on one side, five people on one side, like this. So the Prophet ﷺ, one of his journey, he addressed them and told them, إِنَّ تَفَرُّقَكُمْ هَذَا فِي في الأودية والشعاب من عمل الشيطان. You're dispersed and being distant from each other, okay, when we go camping, this is from the instigation of the shaitan, okay? The shaitan tries always to keep us distant from each other. The Sahaba, when they heard this, from this moment, they start any time the Prophet ﷺ go to a rest area or a stop or camping, they get so close to each other to such a degree, if he take a table or a blanket and he put it there, that all of them will be sitting on it. They get so close to each other. This is something also that we have to understand during the Salah. And we notice that in some of the people who practice a madhab, without mentioning a name, is not only the sisters and the brothers, they say they stand about four fingers from each other. So basically, if you come between a line from wall to wall, and three, four, five people want to get into this line, they will easily fit in. Because they found him standing, and he's standing like this, and about four fingers between his finger, his toes and the other person's toes, and the shoulders. This is not the sunnah, okay? And the Prophet ﷺ warned us again is this, and he says the shaitan, the little shaitan, baby shaitans, they come and squeeze in these places, okay? So when we sit in a class, sometimes they found, you understand, maybe four sisters in this wall and one sister by herself there, okay? This is not the proper way. We don't learn to accumulate, you understand, to add more knowledge. We learn to practice and to be guided and to put it in action. And this is part of building the brotherhood and sisterhood, okay? So hopefully, inshallah, we're talking especially to those people who come to the class, because those people who come to the class, I look to them in a different way, that who people who are concerned about improving their deen, improving their iman, okay? And if no, he understand, can hear us, he should come in, because your mother was searching for you, I don't know where did you go. So please, brother Nuh or Noah, wherever you are, try to show up. So these people who come here, if I did not, you understand, tell them, I feel that I'm being betrayed you. I see the false and I'm not pointing to you. Especially as the Prophet ﷺ told us, Al-mu'min lil-mu'min kal-mir'ah. A believer to a believer like a mirror. If you have anything in your face, or you have a white kufi, and for some reason you're doing something with their, under the hood, and now some oil, let's say oil, all right, it's not oil usually, but you have this
lint or dust, soot.
Yes, maybe.
All kinds of stuff.
Yeah, all kind of stuff. And come, you understand? So you don't see yourself. But somebody will tell you, oh, you have something there in your kufi, okay? Mm-hmm. Now you take it off and you shake it, or you take a napkin and do something like that, you see? So the Prophet ﷺ brought us from one another to be what? Like a mirror. If you look in the mirror, you're going to see yourself. Now you'll be able to perfect, complete, get yourself in the proper appearance. So we're supposed to complete one another. We're supposed to be reflection for one another, and not for somebody take it personal when the imam points something to them. Because people get offended by somebody mentioning their name, or single, they call it single in me. But this is not a single, this means a caring. You understand? This one thing that I meant to start the class with, but we're still working about certain adab and certain behavior that we need to teach it to our children, and we need to monitor them and make sure they are doing it, okay? And we need to get this manzuma or this list of behavior to be part of our daily practice, okay? And especially the leaders, principals, teachers, older people, they have to be practicing these things so our teenagers, boys and girls, not even our teenagers, boys and girls, the little ones, they will see it. Like last week when we were talking about the salam, and how Anas radiallahu anhu, when he passed by little kids, he greets them with assalamu alaikum. He didn't say this is the little kids. Why? Because you giving them example. And he said, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he passed by the kids, he did this. So we need to learn and we need to act on what we learn and they try to be example for the new generation. All the mess that you see nowadays happening everywhere is because the children or that the parents or the teachers or the imams who carry the institution of discipline or teaching. In most cases, there is no an institution for discipline nowadays. They have an institution for education only, okay? Discipline became something like is already in the storage room, okay, forgotten. But those people, they have to know these things and to be part of their daily practice and to bring about a change. We see the corruption that happened today among the Muslims and non-Muslims. It's not going to be solved until we go to the tarbiyah. All right? People killing, people backbiting, people shooting, okay? Violence by different people, against different people, discrimination among one country or one race, even among the Arab and among Muslims. You find things like this, okay? So unless the people will learn the discipline and they start implementing the things in their life, all the things is not going to change. Okay? Having to understand security camera, having police tracking the people, what they're doing, spying in the people, trying to invade other country, all the things bring more violence. It's not going to change. It has to come about some kind of education and discipline, okay? It has to be some kind of a setting examples by action, not only by words. So today we're going to be talking about one of the things that we suppose to be discipline or part of our discipline, which is about the siwak. And even by listening to the title itself, siwak, cleaning the teeth, using toothbrush or toothpaste or something like this, okay? It's something, say, you're talking about building a nation and you coming to talk about brushing your teeth. What, this man is crazy, he's coming from where, you understand? Where he live, you see? We talking about nations killing other nations and nuclear bomb and all these things, and you're talking about toothbrush. There is a story in the early ages, we used to hear it as if it was a hadith or something, but it's not. But was the goal or the purpose of this story is to show you the importance of learning and the practicing the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The story goes like this, that one time the Sahaba, okay, as example, part of the discipline, because we consider Brother Abdul Haq to be one of the team, so he's not going to be embarrassed if I single him now, he entered. Number one, he didn't say assalamu alaikum to us, he said it, but we did not hear it. Number two, he did not greet the musalla, although that he pray outside. Outside is not a mosque. You see, the mosque is here. So the proper way that the person will say assalamu alaikum, he makes two rak'at, and after this he will sit down. This is part of the tarbiyah. Although he knows these things, but this becomes a part of the observer or the teacher to point things to his members that he expected them to be assuming this position for the new generation. Back again to the story, Brother Abdul Haq, that they saying, you want to hear the story first? Brother, you see, it's okay, I'll swallow it, no problem. And this part of the tarbiyah also that we, but not, some people really think that the sheikh wanted, is this okay? Oh, he was scratching, I'm sorry. That I'm trying to have self-recognition and somebody have to call me imam or not. I don't care you call me imam, you don't call me nothing, okay? But to learn about the tarbiyah. Because, you know what? If you're in Egypt and you call somebody like Brother Habib, as example, even I myself, which one is older? I don't know. I think I'm a little bit. But anyway, I call him Brother Habib. I don't remember that I say Habib, okay? Or sometimes I may, but always Brother Habib. In America, all right, among the Muslims, he found they calling Amina, Khadija, maybe Sister Zainab, because Sister Zainab raised my children, so everybody call her Sister Zainab. But with other sister, maybe they call them by their names. This is a big bad, a big misbehavior and no discipline. You don't to call somebody by their names, okay? You say Abla, respect a teacher or auntie, something like this. But here, hey, Mustafa, you see? A little kid, call him Brother Mustafa, you understand? Which may be having children his age, calling him Mustafa. It's so normal. This part of behavior. Anyway, let's go back to the story. Because I think some of you want to hear the story, especially if we have Sister Amina, not Amina's, okay, here. But she missed the lecture, the story about, what was my lecture? The story that I said last 2 weeks when she was not in the class. Was something about what I did. Yeah, about my teacher, what he did to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, she missed this one and she feels sorry she missed it. Anyway, it was a bad story and you're going to cry to know what happened to the imam, but don't worry about it. She liked to hear stories about the imam childhood. Anyway, they said that the Sahaba went in a battlefield and they got defeated. All right? Sahaba, the Tabi'een, anyway, it's a story. It's not. So, say, what's wrong? Why we lost the battle? With the Muslims, they understand, we always win the battle. They start to search, understand among themselves and think about it. And the bottom line, they came to realization that they've forgotten one of the sunnahs of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So what was the sunnah? They remember that most of them stop using the miswak. So they start to get under some of the trees and get some branches and sharp it and brush their teeth. And the story says that when the enemy saw them doing this, okay? Anybody know the miswak?
Yeah.
It's okay. I appreciate it. They, yeah, you should do this. More than this. You're going to get it. So the enemy, they saw them doing what? Brushing the teeth. And they said the enemy start to what? Run away and say, the Muslim are not going to fight us. The Muslim is going to eat us up with their teeth. And they left their stuff and start running. And the Sahaba got to understand so happy that when we went back to the Sunnah, how Allah bless us, put the fear in the enemy's heart to such a degree, they even think that we're going to show them up only by going back to the Sunnah. But this was a story. Anyway, nevertheless, when looking about Islam, concerned about Sunnah of the Miswak, it shows you how beautiful Islam is. Because this is a big part of your hygiene. and is a big means of protection instead of remedy, you understand, your teeth. And you know, especially here in America, how much it costs, you know, to make a repair or to put a fake teeth or to put some wires or to put few nails or screws, whatever that they do, okay? So taking Islam took a care of paying attention to us, which it has a benefit for us physically, okay, and also spiritually. And you're talking about 1400 years ago. There is no toothpaste, there is no toothbrush, there is nothing of these things. But Islam came to teach us about something so simple, but it's so good, that it is part of the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The word miswak is related to the branch of a tree that made from a tree called araq or the olive or any other trees that has this special, you may call it,
bark? Bark?
Bark?
The outside of it?
Yes, what you call the, not the
branch?
Not the branch. You know when he hit the miswak and after this became what you call this hair?
Oh, the inside, yeah.
What do you call this?
Bristles?
Bristles? Yeah. Not bristles.
No.
Okay, bristles?
Bristles,
yeah. It's okay? Yeah. So some trees, when you take it, you understand, and you hammer it like this, mm-hmm. now it doesn't break, mm-hmm. and it doesn't become one piece. No, it became all this...
Mm-hmm. Fibers.
Yeah, okay, fibers, okay. Mm-hmm. But you have to be careful that you don't take any tree, it can be poison. So it's something of experience and people who knows about what trees. Mm. But usually the swag is known to be from main kind of two trees, one called arak and one called the olive trees. Okay, you can do it. You cut piece of the branch and you peel it with a knife or something. And after this, you hammer this half inch that you peel it. You hammer it a little bit, now start to understand, became with like this stuff that like a brush, became turn a brush, natural thing. And this was they used to use as a toothbrush and toothpaste. Okay? In the early time, 1400 years ago. And it's so beneficial. Okay? So beneficial. So Islam talks about the siwak to be mataharatun lil fam mardatun lil rab. Is a means of purification for your mouth and also a means of making Allah pleased with you. Okay? Making Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleased with you. Because what? It's part of the cleanliness. The more that you clean, that the more you understand close to Allah, because Islam teaches about cleanliness. And you found if you observe Islam and the part of cleanliness, okay, you found it's so obvious in Islam. From using the bathroom, okay, cleaning oneself, making ablution, taking a shower, using a miswak, taking a shower for Jum'ah, for gathering, having clean clothes, all the things they found, combing the hair, brushing the hair, putting oil, clipping the fingernails, you found is a lot of emphasis about hygiene and circumcision also. Is a lot of emphasis in Islam about cleanliness. Okay? Because this is something that Allah make it as a sharia, as a laws. And since Allah make it something, when you carry out what Allah command you to do, Allah loves you. And you get blessings for it. Okay? So basically, if we did not have a miswak, you can use any thing, any means for cleaning the teeth. It can be toothbrush, it can be toothpaste, it can be even like in some times, you understand, you have to know how to survive. There is no toothbrush or water, you forgot it, and no convenience store, and you're in some place, wherever, that in the middle of nowhere. You can take a towel as example. And you rub it in your finger, okay? And you can use it inside your teeth and clean your... You have to find a way always, but not while you're sitting in the class. You don't brush your teeth while you're sitting, okay? And some people, their habit, which is not good habit, they'll be sitting in the class with the miswak, okay? And every 2 minutes, understand, or talking with the people and keep doing this, okay? This is not a proper behavior, all right? Especially the talking to the people or listening, not paying attention. But using the miswak in a lot of occasion is something recommended in Al-Islam. And like I said, is act of cleanliness, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love cleanliness. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to use the miswak in many, many occasions. We're going to talk about it in the class also about chewing. Yes, inshallah tonight. The Prophet used to use the miswak a lot. Don't worry about it, okay? But it's more recommended, okay, when the mouth smell change. As example, if you're quiet for a while, it's good to be quiet, by the way. Some people, they think that they're supposed to be broadcast station. Every time they're sitting, talking. And you know, too much you talk is going to drag you sooner or later to backbiting, slandering, talking about people business and all these things that's haram. So being quiet as much as you can, this is something from the adab and the discipline of Islam. And when you quiet, you have time to think more. Reflect in yourself. Try to understand, yeah. But by being quiet, sometimes it causes the mouth change, the smell change. So this would be recommended to use the miswak. When you get up from your sleep, all right, anytime that you took a nap or you're sleeping by night, when you wake up, you use the miswak, because the miswak actually, believe it or not, the miswak is different from the toothbrush, but the toothbrush will do the work of the miswak, okay, and the toothpaste. But the miswak, it has a natural flavor in it, which give a good smell into your mouth and also something to kill the bacteria, okay, without using toothpaste. And it has the ability to clean your teeth better than a toothbrush, all right? Believe it or not. Anyway, also when you get up from your sleep and when you stand for the prayer, before the prayer, also you use the miswak. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, لَوْلَا أَنْ أَشُقَّ عَلَى أُمَّتِي لَأَمَرْتُمْ بِالسُّوَاكِ عِنْدَ كُلِّ الْإِصَلَاةِ. If I did not see it's going to be hardship in my ummah, my followers, I will command them to use the miswak at the time of every prayer. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recommended, but he doesn't want to make it obligatory, because sometimes maybe you forgot it, you don't have it, okay? So that means, oh, I could not make salah because I don't have my miswak. Now I go to the car, I look, oh, I could not find it in the glove compartment. So now I drive home. By the time I come back, the imam made the salah over, they close the mosque, everybody's gone. You see? But the Prophet ﷺ doesn't want to put too much burden in us. But still want us to try to remember about brushing our teeth. And this also shows us the kindness and the concern of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam upon his ummah. He doesn't want to put too much hardship on them, but still try to lead them to what is good and beneficial for them. So he said, if it's not, will be hardship for my ummah, I will ask them or order them to use the miswak upon every prayer time. Also, before a person reciting the Quran, okay, for Jum'ah, when you enter your house, and you know this one of the main things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been reported by Aisha, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam كان إذا دخل بيته بدأ بالسواك. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to start when he entered his house. He used to start with what? With the miswak. It's because he understands he's going to talk to his wife. He may even give her a kiss, okay? So he did not understand after he ate, whatever it is, what smell. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of concern, and this shows you also the proper treatment to the wife, that how you be nice to your family, to your wife, be clean, presentable, okay, be not to understand if you've been quiet for a whole hour, okay, or you astaghfirullah for smoking cigarette, may Allah help us all, okay, or some of us, or some who may, I don't know, I'm not talking about, and if somebody maybe hears a class and they smoke cigarette, okay, can you imagine, understand, somebody go talk to his wife, or even kissing his wife, and he has all this nicotine in his, it's so bad, you understand, but we need to slow down from this stuff, okay, and try to understand the Muslim's supposed to be good in everything, all right? The way you talk, the way you smell, the way you appear, everything, okay? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to start when he entered his house with the miswak, preparation for eating his, for meeting his wife or talking with his family, okay? And it is a blessing to use the miswak, change the smell of your mouth, to remove the leftover or whatever crumbs or anything from the food, or being sleeping, all these things. Also for gathering, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had recommended it for Jum'ah, because now it's not you and your wife only, or you and your Muslim brother, now you're going to be surrounded by other people. So now when you are surrounded by other people, now is more recommended that you be concerned. You understand? About how you're going to be sitting beside somebody or prostrating beside somebody in your right, in your left, and after this, your mouth is smelled like, I don't want to say it. Because somebody said, wow, how does the Imam say a word like this? You know what? Anyway, let's go to one of the other adab. Believe it or not, is real. Some people, the mouth smell like, you know, where you relieve yourself, okay? Yeah. Is this what you want to hear it? Okay. Same that I'm a bad boy or what, it doesn't matter, but it's real. We're going to talk also about one of the adabs that we need to discipline ourselves and be a good example for our children and the students. What is the proper behavior, Islamic behavior, concerning sneezing and
yawning.
Okay? One of the adab, subhanAllah, I don't know about any religion. I did not study too much, but I study a good amount about other religion. I do not see any ideology or any religious book have more details like Islam, subhanAllah, more details. And this to show how the Muslim have to be guided in everything. When you sleep, when you go to the bathroom, when you go to the mosque, when you're talking to somebody, or even your fingernail, your mustache, this hair is eating and drinking with you, what, everything, subhanAllah, is so great that it talks and teach us about everything. So from these things also, that behavior that we do and some activities that we do during our day, that what? Sneezing, which is one, and one is the other one is what? You're in, when you fall asleep. From the adab that a person who sneezed, he or she, they will do what? They will praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying what? Alhamdulillah, not to say, oh, all praise due to Allah. Maybe you understand, you Muslim and you did not learn yet. And somebody will say, oh, excuse me. Oh, bless you. Okay? No. You need to learn to say Alhamdulillah. Okay? So if he did so, the rest of the community or those who heard him, they will make dua for him. They will make what? Supplication for him. By saying what? يهديكم الله ويصلح بالكم. You see? And this again to teach us how we are one family, how we care for each other, how we honor our relationship with each other, that make dua for each other, not to have envy, not to have jealousy, not to have, you understand, all these things. It's corruption. It's destroying the Muslim community. For a small thing like this, now Islam teach you make dua for your Muslim brother or your Muslim sister. You say what? Yarhamukallah, yahdikumullah. Yahdikumullah, may Allah guide you. Say, brother, I'm a Muslim, what are you talking about? May Allah guide me. That means may Allah increase you in guidance. May Allah keep you firm in guidance. You see, people can be Muslim and flip. You know, flip-flop, okay? Yeah, today I'm Muslim, tomorrow's something else. Or from 5 to 8 Muslim, and after 8:30, and they are what? Is there a week? No. Don't squeeze the brother too much, that the one sitting in that chair, please. let him feel comfortable, you know. Thank you. He didn't mean it. Please excuse him. Okay, say sorry to him.
I'm sorry.
He said sorry. So you say, Irhamukallah, Yahdikumullah, may Allah guide you. And what? No, I don't. Why are you bothering him? How do you know no one there? You don't believe somebody's there? Allah knows best. You believe in the unseen? Okay. Maybe someone is there. Okay, don't squash it, please. Okay? Anyway, it says, وَيُصْلِحُ بَالَكُمْ. And this is a special dua. You know the bal, the concern, the worry, what's going on in the tasa upstairs, okay? It's too much going on, huh? And the islah is to fix it, to erect it, to make it right, okay? To have ease. Say what? I get you some tanaloy, I get you some aspirin. No, it's something bothering me. When the bell, your worry, huh? So you making dua that Allah to islah, like your car is broken, now you make it islah, like salah, okay, and salih, to fix it. So you're saying, may Allah guide you, and may Allah fix your affair, your worry, your disturbance. Allah put it in ease. This is a beautiful dua. Well, say, Alhamdulillah, Yadikullah, Assalamu alaikum, I'm not even paying attention to what we're saying, eh? But it is a dua. You're asking Allah to bless this person and give him this supplication. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, reported that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, what the meaning is, إِذَا عَطِسَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَقُلْ أَحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ. When one of you sneeze, let him say what? الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ. وَلْيَقُلْ لَهُ أَخُوهُ أَوْ صَاحِبُهُ. And let his brother or his friend, companion, say to him what? يرحمك الله. فإذا قال يرحمك الله فليقل يهديكم الله ويصلح بالكم. Okay. When one of you sneeze, he should say what? Alhamdulillah. Let his brother or his friend, okay, say to him what? يرحمك الله. May Allah send mercy in you. So now you give him in return, you say what? يهديكم الله ويصلح بالكم. Okay, so he gave you a dua uz rahmah, now you give him a dua back, okay? Same way like somebody say assalamu alaikum, you say wa alaikum assalam, or alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. So you sneeze, you say alhamdulillah, so he make dua for you that Allah what? Show mercy towards you. So now you in return making a dua for your Muslim brother because he made dua for you. So this always have to be the relationship among the Muslims. They care for one another. They're for the need of each other. They make dua for each other. Because you're not going to make dua for somebody that you don't care or that, huh? Really, when you love somebody or care for somebody, you're going to make dua for them. That your heart is, okay? يَهْدِيكُمْ اللَّهُ يَصْلَحْ بَلَكُمْ. It's okay, sis. يَهْدِيكُمْ اللَّهُ يَصْلَحْ بَلَكُمْ. Okay? Yes, there is a one, what you call it, in the other side, push it down and hold it down, it turns off. Thank you. All right? So the Prophet ﷺ said, if one of you sneezed, okay, let him say Alhamdulillah. Let him say Alhamdulillah. Why are we saying Alhamdulillah? Did he eat? Did he drink? Guess what? Are you raising your hand? Okay. If you said it right, that means Kabli was your teacher.
No, I read in the science book that when the person sneezes, a lot of germs and bacteria come out of their body.
Okay.
And if you did not sneeze, those things would stay inside to harm us.
50% right. Who can give me the other 50%? Because we, Sister Zainab teaches science, so she knows about this, and she read in the book, but there is something happening to you when you sneeze.
I think it's something with your heart.
No. Okay, your heart. What else?
Breathing to Adam.
Look all your body, look to your face, look to your everything, and that's like a tense situation, okay? Mm-hmm. And subhanAllah, you found your eyes is closed, you understand your. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala capable to hold you in this position. So what happened that after you went in this physical change and this tense condition, Sister Sahira, you follow me? You follow what I'm saying, not what follow me? Okay? Now Allah give you what? Give you a relief and give you release and you went back in your normal condition. So praise Him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? That everything went back because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can hold it in this. But Allah had give you a relief, same thing like when you go to the bathroom. Okay? If this thing is staying, stuck in your stomach, you know what can happen to you. All right? As a result of this, that when you come from the bathroom, you say what? Ghufranaka. And some of the scholars explain why we say Ghufranak, which means what? Oh Allah, forgiveness, okay? Or grant me forgiveness. That when we ate this food and digest the food, and even we relieve ourselves, we did not praise Allah enough or in the proper way. So for Allah give us the ability to relieve ourselves, and why we are shortage in our praise. So we're asking Him to pardon us because we did not praise Him in a manner that fits His head. First, for having it. Secondly, for eating it. Thirdly, for digesting it. Number four, for benefiting from it. And number five, that came out of your body. Now you say, I didn't praise you enough, so forgive me for my shortcoming. You see? So the same way that if somebody could not use the bathroom, it would be disaster. So the same thing about the sneezing, if you get so tense and is not been released and go back in the normal situation. As a result of this, you don't know what? He's thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Alhamdulillah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what? Let his brother, the one who heard him, to say what? Yarhamukallah. May Allah show mercy towards you. And you will say back to him what? يهديكم الله ويصلح بالكم. Part of the proper discipline concerning sneezing, that a person who didn't praise Allah, he will be deprived from the dua and the supplication. Did you get this? Or say it again? That means if I did not practice the proper behavior when I sneeze, what I supposed to do?
Alhamdulillah.
What I supposed to do?
Say.
To say what?
Alhamdulillah.
What I supposed to say?
Alhamdulillah.
If I did not do it, now you are not obligated, neither you are recommended to say me, Yarhamukallah. So now by me not acting in the proper way, the proper discipline of sneezing, I've been deprived from the dua of my Muslim brother. Okay? This is one that we have to understand. So a person who didn't say Alhamdulillah, we are not supposed to give him tashmid. This came in the hadith in the collection of Imam Muslim, إِذَا عَطِسَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَحَمِدَ اللَّهِ فَشَمِّتُوا. If one of you sneeze and he say Alhamdulillah, so shamitu, that means say to him what? يَرْحَمُكَ اللَّهِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَحْمَدِ اللَّهِ فَلَا تُشَمِّتُوا. If he did not say Alhamdulillah, the Prophet said, do not say to him, يَرْحَمُكَ اللَّهِ. Okay? Also, from the proper discipline and adab, when a person sneezes, to cover his face or his mouth or his nose, okay, not to be sneezing in the people's face like this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he used to sneeze, he used to put his hand or his soul, okay, retake the side of your turban or your sleeve or whatever, and you cover your mouth and your nose, okay. Also from the adab, the proper discipline of sneezing, that you try to lower your voice as much as possible. Okay? Some people, when they sneeze, you can hear them from outside. Is this, huh? No, this is not from the adab of sneezing. All right? From the adab and the proper discipline of related to sneezing, that if you give tashmid, say irhamukallah to the person, you understand, up to 3 times. Sometimes the person sneezes, and after they say alhamdulillah, you say irhamukallah. He sneezes again, say what? Alhamdulillah, he said to him, irhamukallah, 3rd time, okay? Now, more than 3, that's something wrong with the person. So now you make dua for him, may Allah heal you. That the person catching cold now is not a normal sneezing, okay? Excuse me. It's not a normal situation now. So in this case, that a person have a catching cold or whatever the case, you can make dua for them. Most the scholars, okay? I'm not saying hadith, or I'm not saying concise opinion, but some of the scholars, they said that you are not supposed to do this with a woman that is not a mahram to you if she's young. Okay? And is not disliked for an older lady, because it's not going to bring about any kind of friendly relation or caring conversation or whatever it may lead to, okay? So for an older lady, and you know in America, 75 years maybe to be older lady. I was surprised, I understand, because I came from a culture that when, especially in the Arif, that means the village part. My father from the city, but by my mother from the country. I told you about the story about my uncle before that, who died in Yemen. Yeah. He got married, his wife, she was, I think, 16, 17 years old when they got married. And I think when he died, she was something, maybe I don't remember exactly, maybe about 22, 23. She never married after this. Can you imagine somebody 22, 25? But when I came to America, and this is not because she's my uncle wife or what, no, this is called, that mean like a shame or aib, something very bad. I'm not saying this Islamically, right? Okay? Islamically, and this goes to the extreme also, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make iddah, waiting period for the woman that her husband died. Mm-hmm. which is 4 months and 10 days after this. She's a woman. She has feeling, she has desire, she has this, okay? But how people, the culture sometimes so strong that they so dedicated to it more than their deen. So can you imagine somebody 25 years old, and this it? Because her husband died, if she get married, this will be a big shame, and will the news will be all over the city, okay? And until today, that I remember that my uncle wife never got married. She had 2 kids, and this was it. From her husband who passed away, and she was a young girl, and this is it, okay? When I came to America, I found something different, okay? Because as example, my first wife, she was 45 years old, all right? Somebody don't know what I'm talking about, and I was 25 years old, okay? And so, to me, it's something but, alhamdulillah, she was a religious woman, you understand, and she was so devoted to her deen, and was this the first marriage, okay? And after this, I was surprised, understand, after start to be, understand more in people life and imams and found matching for people. Sisters, understand, give me resume for found somebody, 60, 62, 65, and keep going up. This in Arabia is so crazy. But it's nothing wrong with this. Okay? So, say that if a woman, older lady, sneeze and say, Alhamdulillah, you can say, Arhamukallah. Because it's not going to bring about, it's not to understand a hope of carrying some kind of sexual attraction to each other. But if she's young, they say, is this like for you to make tashmid for her? Anybody understand? Okay, it was a nice story, is it? You want to hear these things to wake up, huh? All right.
Okay, question, Chef. So you said that if a young sister sneezed and she said, Alhamdulillah.
Yeah.
Do you supposed to say, Yahamukallah, or you're not supposed to say
it? I say most of the scholars, they dislike this. And I, to be honest with you, I could not answer you because, but the hadith, when you say, you know, because in Islam is so concerned about protection, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that the fitna of Bani Israel, the first fitna of Bani Israel, first trial, cause them to deviate or to fall into sin is women, okay? So the more, and this is the reason that you find in Islam that there is segregation and there is the separation between, you understand, women all the way in the back, okay, the men all the way to the front, they don't mix it, they do not socialize together, things like this. So all these things to avoid any kind of developing any kind of a relationship between the opposite sex. So you try to be, to avoid it. As example, when you pass by a woman, you understand that Islamically understand, or this what the scholars say, that you don't give her salam if she's not a mahram to you. That means she's not your sister, she's not your wife, she's not your aunt. That means you could not marry her under any condition. So you call this is mahram. You say you can give salam to her, but any other woman not, unless she's older or something like this. What is the age here, wrong, be older so we can know which sister we can. So, why? Because it's, huh?
It depends on your age. If you're 16, 30 years old.
Okay. So it's saying that, no, because what is, the way how it happened is say, Nazratun, Fabtisamatun, Fasalamun, Fawadun, Falikaun. It say, there is a poetry say, first is a look, how things develop. And after this, a smile. You see, her sister, you understand, so he saw her, okay, and he kept walking. The next thing you understand, he saw her, and it was a smile, and kept walking, okay? But the word and the smile is not stopped, okay? And after this, the next time now you get more encouragement, or she got some encouragement, said, Assalamu alaikum. The next time will be what? Assalamu alaikum, Akil. How are you doing today? Okay. Okay. And after this, say, it's going to be develop little bit by little bit until will be a meeting, and after this maybe going to the movies and. So basically the scholars from the outcome of the whole teaching of Islam, they drive this to say it is disliked for a man to answer a woman if she sneezed. I did not say, all the scholars say this. What I say about it, I say Allah knows best. I'm not going to tell you do it or don't do it, okay? But maybe because I'm old, am I old?
Depends.
Yeah. Anyway, it's what, 60? Was it 60?
Only as old as you think you are.
Wait, I forgot, wallahi, for a second, 1 second. 65?
Six.
Eh?
Six.
No, come on, Habib.
Yeah, this year.
Six what? Oh, you mean 66?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you meant that six, okay. No, it's not. 66, okay?
Yeah.
So I don't know if this consider what it is here, I understand. Anyway, so by the Hijra calendar, I'm 70 or something, okay? So anyway, so it says that for a person who is older, that you can say, Arhamukallah, a brother or a sister. If not, some of the scholars or majority of the scholars say, do not. Why? Not to start any kind of graduate relationship between you and her. And Allah knows best. Okay? As for yawning, okay, this is a voice or feeling sleepy and tired, and after this, start to open. Everybody know what yawning means, okay? Call a tafa'ub. I forgot to tell you something. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He loves sneezing. Okay? Mm-hmm. That not mean that you're going to go and make yourself sneeze by force. Okay? But tafa'ub, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislike it. And for the adab and the proper behavior, if a person have to yawn, okay, to control it as much as he or she can. Due to the hadith of Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, أَمَّا التَّفَاؤُفَ فَمِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ. As for yawning, it's from what? From shaitan. Because shaitan want to what? Make you lazy, sleepy, okay? So he calls you, understand, this kind of fatigue and tiredness, and as a result of this, you come with opening your mouth and making this noise. It is from the shaitan. فَإِن تَثَاءَبَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَرُدَّهُ مَا اسْتَطَعُ. When one of you yawning, let him or her control it as much as he can. That because فَإِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ إِذَا تَثَاءَبْ ضَحِكَ مِنْهُ الشَّيْطَانِ. Due to the fact that when one of you yawning, the shaitan will laugh at him. If you could not control it in your own, you can put your hand and control your mouth, okay? Mm-hmm. With your hand, bare hand, or with your sleeve or anything like this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that when one of you yawn, let him hold his mouth with his hand. Due to the fact that shaitan will enter when you leave your mouth open. You shouldn't be making noise when you yawn. Due to the hadith which is the collection of Imam Muslim and others, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْعِطَاسِ. Indeed, Allah loves sneezing. وَيَكْرَهُ التَّفَاؤُبُ. And Allah dislike what yawn. فَإِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ إِذَا قَالَ هَا. Okay? And do like this. This is no. ضَحِكَ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنْ. Shaitan will be laughing at him or her. So do not make fool out of yourself with the shaitan, at least the shaitan laugh at you. That you need to control this noise, and you need to cover your mouth, and try to control it as much as you can. Let me say something before I forget here. Some people, and I forgot, I don't know if I put it in my book better or not. Somebody will review it, please, and tell me. Some people, when they join, they say what? Oh, Billah, the shaitan regime.
Yeah.
Is it right?
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
And this is not sunnah. When you sneeze, they say, Alhamdulillah. But when you want to say, you have nothing to say. Mm-hmm. What you're supposed to act, not to say, is to control it
mm-hmm.
and to cover your mouth, okay? But for saying, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, this is not part of the sunnah. We stop here for tonight. Hopefully, inshallah, that we try to live with this kind of adab and discipline, teach it to our children and the students, and make it part of our daily behavior so we can get closer to Allah with the daily behavior, inshallah. We have a few minutes for anybody who have comments or question or correction related to the subject. Yes, ma'am.
I have two questions.
Come in.
The first one is, can you advise someone to say Alhamdulillah if they don't say it when they sneeze?
If a person is a newcomer, new shahada, they don't know about these things, we can teach them, we can remind them, to train them. But if a person know what is the proper thing, he or she deprives himself from the dua of the other person. You do not.
And if somebody sneezes three times in a row, do they have to say Alhamdulillah three times, or do they just say it once?
When he finished sneezing. Walaikum salam. Okay. Anybody else? Yes.
You made a comment about when you see a brother or something, you said brother or sister to them. I wanted to know, whenever you have a professor or there's someone that is a Muslim, you call them Mr. or Mrs. or Doctor or anything like that. Is that Islamic or
is this under sneezing or yoyin?
It's none of that, but you were saying about this.
Okay, book. It is forbidden in Islam to call a non-Muslim Mr. Okay? Because this in our language understand Sayyid who Allah. Allah is the master. And if you call a kafir Mr. or Sir or whatever it is, you understand that mean if he is, that mean a kafir could not be a Mr. And you displease Allah by doing this.
Okay.
You say, I forgot what is the statement of the hadith. فَإِنْ كَانَ كَذَلِكَ فَقَدْ أَغْضَبَ اللَّهُ. Okay, because a kafir is not a mister. You know what is mister is different from sir or whatever it is?
You make an equivalent between mister and master. There's no, they're not equal. They're not the same. Or synonymous.
In English, they're not.
In English?
They're not the same.
They're not the same.
Okay,
mister,
if you say mister,
yeah,
so mister Adli means what?
It's
I know, this is what I'm saying.
It doesn't mean master. It doesn't mean like putting a person on a high pedestal.
I will investigate
like
this.
Say it. It doesn't.
No, I will search it. I try to ask other people because I myself understand. I go and talk with many people and I be very uncomfortable and understand. Even the judge, you understand, I don't say your honor and things like this.
That's another matter. Yeah.
Okay, mm-hmm. But. So you say master is different from
master.
Master.
Yes.
There is nobody called somebody's master.
No,
I will check, inshallah, see if Brother Mahmoud will help me with it.
I have another question about sneezing. In America, when you sneeze, people telling you...
Bless you.
Yeah, what you should tell them? You should say thank you or just discard them.
I think you understand it's nice that we be nice to those who are nice to us and be part of fairness, okay?
Well, thank you.
Oh, it's if this, what do you, bless you?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they said,
okay? They say, excuse me first, but after this, you say, bless you? Or what they say?
They say both, either or.
Okay, so it says, she or he say, excuse me, is it?
The one that sneezes.
Yeah, the sneeze one, they say,
excuse
me.
Yeah.
And after this,
the other one says, bless you.
And what, after this, what you say back?
You don't say anything. But
okay.
Say
so,
thank you.
Huh?
Oh, do
you? You say thank you? Okay.
Yeah.
No, say thank you.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Whatever I don't know, I don't know. Okay.
I think.
Thank you.
All right. Anybody else?
Oh, yeah.
Anybody? Second two, number three. Thank you for being here. Jazakumullah khairan. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Allah knows best.
Bismillah.
Hit the red button.
Red button.